Hi, and welcome to this week's shtick. It's the first episode of season 43. And unfortunately, Henry has lost his voice. My name's Sandra Dubbs. I'm standing in for him this week, although he's always present, as you can see, very busily studying the Jewish news. On this week's show, we've got the Multicultural Commissioner, Helen Kapelos, who's speaking at the JCCV AGM about social inclusion and cohesion. Later on in the show, we've got Kate Jenkins, who's the Victorian Human Rights Commissioner, and it'll be very interesting to hear what she has to say. And my role is that I'm part of a community which is called My Whole Food Community. And for the last 30 years, I've been involved with educating and teaching people about health and nutrition, especially through cooking classes. So I'm excited that at the moment, I'm actually crowdfunding my long time coming cookbook. So it's got 30 years of favorite recipes that people have voted in as being favorite. It's more than just a cookbook. There'll be lots of stories about people who are in the whole food community, and there'll be lots of tips and healthy pantry ideas, what to keep in your pantry, and other nutritional advice. So I need your help to get this project funded, and you'll be rewarded in so many ways. So now we're going to go to the Multicultural Commissioner, Helen Kapelos.
In terms of practicing social cohesion, the Jewish community serves as an exemplary leader because through their diversity and adversity, they've created a model of resilience that we can all learn from, and we still do learn from that every day, and an open-hearted one at that. Earlier this year, I think it was my first couple of weeks when I had, 18 meetings in a day, I met with you, Jennifer, and with David, and you introduced me to a wonderful book. Do you remember what that was? Yes, Jonathan Sacks. So who in this room is aware of Jonathan Sacks and his wonderful work, of course? So I don't need to tell you. But look, I have been absolutely mesmerised by his teaching and his books, and I'm using it a lot in lectures at the moment. I love what he describes as we're now living in the conscious presence of difference, and how our ideology, or the politics of ideology, has now shifted to the politics of identity, which I think really does encapsulate what's happening now. And that's manifested in the street, at work, in the media, where we constantly encounter cultures whose ideas and ideals are unlike ours. And that, of course, can be a profound threat to our identity. Religion, he says, has emerged to become a powerful presence on the world stage because it's one of the great answers to the question of identity. But identity divides. It can also divide when the process of creating an us creates a them, the people not like us. In the very process of creating community within their borders, religions can create conflict across their borders. And it's really interesting, I noticed Malcolm Turnbull actually loosely referred to those exact teachings just recently. So I wonder whether he's also been inspired greatly by the work. One of my favourite quotes from Jonathan Sacks is, "The test of faith is whether I can make a space for that difference. Can I recognise God's image in someone who is not in my image, whose language, faith, ideals are different from mine? If I cannot, then I have made God in my image instead of allowing him to remake me in his." And if there's one theme, of course, that underscores a lot of the work that we do, it is, of course, as I mentioned, the right to belong in a community, but as an individual, to be proud of your religious and cultural diversity and to feel safe in it. And shortly before I came along tonight, I wasn't quite sure how I would fill the 15 minutes, but I thought, look, what I might do is just draw briefly from a lecture that I had conducted the other evening at the State Library, because I feel that the themes really, even though they were pertaining to youth, really do pertain to all of us as well. And what I did was deliberately source works that I guess are also outside the various schools of thought that most people draw from within the sector. And there was one author that I came across called Peter Block, and he wrote a book called The Community and the Structure of Belonging. He explores in that book what he defines as the concept of our fragmented community and how to achieve transformation within it. And we found a lot of synergy in this book at the VMC with what our communities tell us, and namely that each sector of our community is working hard on its own purpose, but parallel effort will not make a community. So developing identity emerged as a very strong theme, and it was raised actually at every single forum that we had and related directly to our youth seeking a place of acceptance. What they told us was that continuous negative stereotyping impacts negatively upon diverse communities and makes them feel that they don't belong, that media should not mix up terrorists with normal citizens such as them. An obvious conclusion, of course, but one that the media don't seem to understand or be able to conceptualise in their reporting. And I'm speaking as a, yes, disgruntled media person who faced a lot of these issues, and I was constantly frustrated. I was working at Channel 9, I remember, back when, I don't know if you remember, it was in Sydney actually, in the gang rape trials. It was a huge story at the time, and not long after 9/11. And it was the start of Islamophobia at that time, and it was really dividing and polarising the community. And I remember speaking to my news editors about how that would manifest in our reporting, and, you know, that we should really be seeking a place of intercultural understanding, because it's always cyclical racism. There's always someone to pick on. And those conversations never used to go very far, is all I'll say. Anyway, our youth did come back to us with a solution. It's one I've just touched on, and what they want is more education and intercultural understanding, promoting a better understanding of all of our cultures. And I'm happy to say that at least that's creeping into some school curriculums now, where we are learning about, I guess, how our differences really also create so many similarities, and finding the similarities in those differences. And that, I really think, creates a we are them kind of picture. And while we know that resilient communities are also connected communities, perhaps we feel it is our youth that hold the key to that communal transformation, where the need to understand each other transcends one of our favourite national sports, and that is having a good old-fashioned problem or something to whinge about. And what we feel, I guess, in a lot of the community forums that we've had, not just with our youth, but of a wider nature, really indicate that most or more often than not, individual actions are serving a higher cause. And what we'd like to do is ensure that that cause is one that might benefit humanity as a whole. Because most of us do find a cause to champion in our lifetime. More often than not, the individual's cause serve a higher cause than ourselves. And so through that, we go from I to we, and we look at what can be created together, because that understanding of ourselves is the reinforcement of our identity. But within the context of a community, it's where the real sense of belonging can be achieved. The most cohesive societies are those which secure every member's right to belong.